So the bond market consists of a different set of investors, and unfortunately, after the entire issue with ILFS, the investor confidence of these set of investors, at least we have seen that confidence go down drastically. It has improved over the last one and a half months, but September to February was a very, very bad phase. And honestly, the Indian bond market hasn't picked up at the pace it should be picking up at. There's a lot more requirement. I mean, it should be simple, right? During the construction phase, you have, you know, lenders like IREDA, Tata support the construction finance. 1 or 2 years post-operations, the bond market should pick up these projects. But that's not happening at the frequency that one would expect, especially foreign capital. And the second sort of issue that has happened is with the kind of issues that certain mutual funds have faced because of the downward trend for SL or ILFS, the mutual fund financing has also dried up, which was a very important piece for the bond market. So bond market needs to pick up, and we need to provide that comfort to these investors, which will primarily happen from improvements in credit rating, not only of specific entities, but also of the country as a whole. Because once that happens, you're going to get better and cheaper financing with sort of more confidence by these investors.
I just wanted to ask Harvinder and Mr. Abhilak Singh this as well. One, on experience of ILFS and impact it has on, you know, mutual funds, if you can just speak on that. Two, it's all related. To rating, right? And do you believe that a better rating or a more credible rating, even for the renewable space, would enable more funds to come? And, you know, Harvinder, practical impact on this space because of what's happened to the mutual funds?
So, Vishal, right, at least said this rating is a, like, mutual funds have their guidelines to invest only in SFGs rated above some rating, some credit rating. So when the time in ILFS things went bad, so we have faced tight liquidity for NBFCs, which leads to increase in our cost substantially. And then we also understood that we cannot rely only on Indian source of funds for our business to run. So that's why we tied up with foreign, we tried to reach foreign markets, and we get a line from GCF Clean Climate Fund to fund finance rooftop projects. That will help us to reduce costing for financing of rooftop projects. So as a long-term thing, we need to improve ratings of our projects or our industry, and we need, like, at this place, people like IREDA can come into picture when they have introduced instrument like rating of like credit enhancement, which help us to place some projects with the mutual fund market. Even otherwise, we were not able to place. So with the credit enhancement, the rating become A plus in category or double A category, and we are able to place those rates with the mutual fund market. So rating definitely is very, very important. Plus NBFCs and like us and IREDA, and we have to find out some sources of funds from international market, because our rating is good. So like we are AAA rated right now. So those players might not be interested directly invest in the project. They will be interested to invest in Tata Cleantech as a name. We can be a platform from through which we can take that part of risk, and we invest in the project at a comparatively better, able to provide a better cost to the developer.
Yeah, definitely better rating always is good. As far as IREDA is concerned, see, now IREDA itself actually are interest rates linked to this credit rating based on our internal rating. Furthermore, we also give some concession. So we get actually two ratings. One is a internal rating and other is a external rating. So if better rating comes, so we have categorized all ratings into four category. So fourth one, we do not give any concession. For one, if outside is a credit rating is a one, then we will give 0.25% over and above the interest rate discount. Then 0.2 and 0.15. So this is actually mechanism. So IREDA itself gives. And then regarding this credit enhancement scheme, we have introduced very recently, and in fact we have done one project also. So under that, whoever want to raise funds from the market, they can come, and we can give the credit enhancement guarantees under that. Some we can sanction, And then, of course, the that rating will be better, and the companies and the developers, they may be able to raise actually at a little cheaper rate.
Very quickly, I'll be moving on to the company side of you know what they look when they're trying to raise financing, equity, and debt. But Karan, just quickly on just to stick to rating, because it's been such an issue the last few months. More standardized regulation, more stringent regulations from SEBI and RBI are both required, because right now it seems to be still very ambiguous in terms of the regulatory regime as to what standards they need to adhere to, even with the recent amendment.
No, definitely. I think the regulation needs to be more, a lot more objective compared to what it is currently. I mean, it's sort of a joke that the rating is AA one day and it's D the very next day. It cannot happen. That's not a mature market, and that sort of reflects very poorly on the credit rating agencies themselves, because they should be analyzing these factors and the rating has to come down in a phased manner. So you do definitely need a lot of objective criteria. It's tough, I understand. It's tough because there are so many factors involved, you know, across sectors. But you need objective criteria, and you need to have an imposition of a higher penalty if those criteria are breached, which I think is a big problem. I think the lack of enforcement has led to this entire downturn, because not only for the rating agencies, but also for the auditors. I mean, these issues could have been picked up very easily. That's what we're seeing in a lot of companies which have sort of gone down recently. If these issues were picked up in early phases, it wouldn't be in such a crisis at this stage. So yes, I think objective criteria are important for rating agencies, and rating agencies and auditors have to be made accountable if there is a lapse in their respective scope of work.
Thanks, Karan. So just moving on, Mr. Kapoor, to you and Rupam as well. You are the main recipients and clients of this funding. What do you look for when you, what are the level of debt and equity that is ideal when you look for investment to come in, whether from lenders or private equity investors? What is your preference and what's been your experience between the two? And you know, what would your advice really be to founders and promoters in this space when they're looking to raise capital?
Like, again, I'm saying the calculation in Excel. Now, like case of ILFS or case of other sectors, everybody is calculating as per contract, it is a payment of 30 days or 60 days. But when payments are coming in 6 months' time, 9 months' time, what you will do? Because suddenly you will find last time government has given support to all DISCOMs. Now slowly, that time the payment has been improved, good one. But slowly, if you see again quarter to quarter, month to month, again things are slipping. I am from last 32 years in power sector. We have seen this cycle from 91 onwards. Every time it happened. So basically, we are making the mechanism, but we are not catching the right cat basically in the room. So rating agencies also, what they will do? Like today payments are coming, now somewhere election is there, state election, this election, that election, and suddenly you will not get the payment. That payment will go to somewhere else. So what even rating agency or what anybody will do, either as an owner, from where, because he also have the fund flow quarter to quarter for different projects, from where suddenly he will match this cash flow requirement. Basically issue is, project is not wrong. Projects are right, like solar and wind, the natural resources are there. Issue is only the cash flow. And total gambit is the cash flow, basically. That why I am started from the discounting of the bill.
Just a small point there, sir. I mean, this problem with the DISCOMs has been there for a while, as you correctly pointed out. And there are sort of mechanisms which certain developers are implementing to try and address this. But Also, if you look at the analysis that a credit rating agency does, a lot also depends on which DISCOM is the ultimate beneficiary from the plant. So if there is a problem with these DISCOMs not sort of funding, the rating itself ought to fall, which is not happening because there is no close monitoring. And if that sort of starts happening, that will give a realistic picture of the project to the lenders and the investors. Because right now, a lot of these companies are not in that space. But 3 years hence, we a lot of these companies will be listed entities with a lot of retail money involved in them. And at that time, I think credit rating these agencies have to take these guys way more seriously as opposed to, close set of investors.
No, I will give you some analogy about this. Like in India, we have a very constrained infrastructure like road. Now traffic police is saying you're jumping the red light, you're not doing this and that. So rating agencies like that. But problem is somewhere else. You do not have the proper flyover, you do not, your red light, that light is not working, you have somewhere, somebody have cut the road or something due to people are going the crossroad. So take rating agency as a traffic police. Like what I'm seeing, I'm staying in Indirapuram. Now when Merit Express has formed, now no traffic police is there. Everything is smooth, everything is going rightly. So issue is that basically. So it is it is not the one party in the, all stakeholders are responsible. It is not like when the lenders are doing the project, why they are financing, they know that it's a particular DISCOM or particular company is doing, how they have financed this. So it is not only the one stakeholder are responsible for the total. Everybody has to improve.
Absolutely, Mr. Kapoor. Coming to you, Rupam, from Clean Max, poster boy, so to speak, of raising a significant amount of capital. So what's your experience been? Because you'll have raised both private equity, some level of debt, to the developer and the company community, the borrower community. What would your perspective be between the two types of financing? What's the right, balance apart from Excel sheets that you have seen in your experience with Clean Max?
Good afternoon, everyone. So definitely the scenario has changed. I mean, talking about 3 years before, the expectation of the investors, the lenders, the banks, NBFCs were way too high. Now looking at the generation numbers that are coming, I mean, as Gautam Ji was saying that, we take the numbers in the Excel sheet based on the PVCIST. Now the way the climate is changing, the way we are having sudden rainfalls in February and March, the numbers are just jumping. So definitely the expectations have decreased owing to the actual generation of the plants. Along with that, the pressure from the client end. So the growing down level of the per unit prices that are happening, that is one of the major regions which is driving all these things. Apart from that, the investors have now started taking, more of interest in how their plants are performing. So earlier what used to happen was, okay, I've invested a particular amount in some plant or I've given it to a particular company. The returns are these numbers. I am getting the returns. I'm happy. Now with the changing scenario, they are getting into the IoT space. They are getting into the remote monitoring space. They are having dedicated teams, making their teams sit down and see how the plant is performing. So many changes are happening with a portfolio of almost 500 megawatt and still increasing. Clean Max is also taking taking all these things into a very positive stride. And we have, as you said, we have a mix of both debt and equity also. So what we are progressing through is in a fashion that the expectation should be real. It should not be seen that, okay, on an Excel sheet, the numbers are way high, like 20%, 22% or 25%. And then in actual, we are getting numbers, crossing down to 14%, 15%. So a realistic margins have to be taken, realistic generations have to be taken. The society, solar industry has matured. We have the real-time figures from various places across India. We now know that, okay, in this particular region, for the last 1 year, the irradiation would be of this level. So the generation that would be coming would be of like 1100 units or 1200 units. So number games is all this is all about. So numbers have to be right. The right amount of technology has to be there. Robotic cleaning, all those things are coming into picture. So it's a vast field. And yes, now we can say the industry is going in the right direction. So earlier it was all, let us get so many returns, let us get so many numbers. Now I think it's the right time that people have started realizing that, okay, in Rajasthan, I'll be getting these many figures. In Delhi, I'll be getting these many figures. So like one of the panelists was saying, in Leh, you get a lower cost as compared to Delhi. That's bound to happen because Leh is giving you a high numbers with respect to generation. Leh is giving you almost like 1500 units or 1600 units. Whereas in Delhi, now is the scenario that you hardly get 1000 units or 1100 units. So I think that's how we are maturing and that's the correct way.
Sir, any response to what Rupam said? Because I mean, they are a company which has certainly attracted attention for all the good reasons. And so I don't know if the panel has any perspectives on the private equity side. And Karan, I don't know what you see with your clients. At the end of the day, with all the debt that you will continue to have, if you don't have private equity investment in this sector, then it is going to fall behind. So if any in the panel have...
No, certainly. I mean, any project consists of a component of debt and equity. And to respond to the earlier question you'd raised to Mr. Kapoor, what is the ideal debt equity ratio? I think from a developer side, they're looking at a debt equity of 80-20, maybe 85-15, the higher the better. But lenders seem to be comfortable with the range of 75-25 from what we have seen in the past. So private equity is a key driver in most renewable energy projects, whether it's IPP or rooftop. I think what's going to be interesting in my view and something which has to develop in the future is how the financing for storage will sort of come up and how that will be made viable, because that's something that's I think we've reached a stage of maturity, as Rupam had said, on the entire rooftop space, the IPP space for solar wind. I think storage is the next big thing that we are seeing in the market, along with the hybrid projects. And how financing will be raised for these projects seems to be very interesting. I personally don't see a huge amount of difference between hybrid and the other projects in the long term. But storage is something that a lot of our clients have been grappling with, because as of now, it doesn't seem to be very viable. But I think 6 years or 7 years ago, neither did solar seem to be very viable as an option. So hopefully with improvement of technology, we're going to see that happening. We're going to see a lot more private equity in storage initially, because lenders are going to be conservative. But hopefully that will reach a stage of where we have today in the IPP space.
I think speaking of technology is the right time to bring Tanya in, because her product, her business model is largely based on technology, and it kind of impacts all the discussions we've had as a source of financing, whether it's discounting, bill discounting, or trading, or storage. So maybe Tanya, you could just explain what you've been doing on the blockchain side, trading, and then we can respond to that.
Thanks a lot. You're absolutely right. I think all the discussions that have happened so far, I feel there's a little bit I can contribute here. So while investments and what kind of investments are coming in and the problems in getting those investments and the resistance that is usually faced in getting these investments for solar power projects are also influenced by the kind of payback you can expect out of solar power projects. I mean, I know it has sort of stabilized, but there is some bit of innovation that can be done even in the technology side, which can improve payback, reduce the need for investments, and probably impact overall CapEx projects. So maybe, you know, there would be a rise in capex projects eventually from such a technology. So what I am talking about is the use of blockchain for peer-to-peer energy trading. So what we see so far is mostly net metering, which sort of impacts, which you sort of take into consideration in your Excel sheet calculations as well. But suppose, you know, peer-to-peer energy trading does become very prevalent. The UP regulations already has it in its, you know, the newer regulations that came in January. Now, suppose we see that countrywide, you know, the tariff that you get by selling to, let's say, your neighbor, or, you know, between two industries, that would be a better tariff as compared to the tariff that you get for net metering. So that way, it's going to make it more viable definitely for the consumer and reduce the payback period. Now the question comes about the DSM, which is deviation settlement mechanism. How does the grid maintain stability? So of course, the DSM, you know, the DSM regulations will be taken into consideration in such a scenario. To maintain grid discipline and to have some kind of an estimate of what kind of power is going to flow into the grid and what is the reduced amount of power that the DISCOM will need to buy to supply. But having said that, such a thing is absolutely possible, and this is going to reduce transmission losses and improve payback and as a result make capex even more viable. So I feel something like this, if it is funded, let's say, for society-wise or you know, even city-wise, this can even attract a lot more investments. So that's my thought. I'll be happy to hear from everybody.
I think open to Harvinder from, again, a NBFC background. How would you look at this business? Would you look, be looking at financing something like that?
So I feel this blockchain will definitely bring transparency in the system. So right now, if we are worried about whom to sell, whom not to sell, whom we can trust, who can be a better off-taker, who cannot be better off-taker. So right now, my only dependence is on the rating as of now or from the financial analysis. But something like blockchain will give me a track record of its performance in previous years or previous months. At point of time, like if you start doing such thing now, everything is like whatever power somebody, suppose Amplus or CleanMax is selling to a big off-taker like Oracle or Accenture. So they, right now we are financing them based on the comfort that these are the good names and they will be paying on time. But some small players which are even maybe equally good, but because they don't have a, suppose a some rice mill in the interior of Haryana who want to buy the power at a lower cost. But some financial institution like us will not be keen to finance that project because they are not aware about this guy. But if there's a blockchain thing or some transparency, some track record of his buying power from the suppliers on a timely payment, then it will give a comfort for someone like me. So this is like bringing technology, like fintech, what we can say. So the blockchain and all will bring more transparency, and it's a, I think it's a technology for future, and we should try to look at it in a more positive sense rather than just saying it's difficult to implement.